My mom is a nurse and my dad's a doctor, so they're heavily invested in the medical side of things. I told them about my diagnosis of BPD, and my mom says to me, BPD? Well, how can you have BPD? You're so nice. And I was taken aback because I didn't know the side of borderline personality had this dark side to it. But at the same time, I knew that they also needed a re-education or a refresher course.
Fact, 1 in 16 Americans is impacted by borderline personality disorder. 20 to 25% of psychiatric inpatients and outpatients are diagnosed with BPD. Myth number one, BPD is not a real mental illness. Fact, BPD has been in the DSM since 1980 and has a reliable diagnostic criteria.
Borderline personality disorder is a serious psychiatric condition that's often misunderstood, but you can break it down into four main areas of difficulty. The first area is emotions. People with BPD experience emotions intensely, and their emotions shift rapidly from one extreme to another. So it's like going through life on an emotional roller coaster. The second area of difficulty is interpersonal relationships. People with BPD very much want to bond with others, but they have great anxiety about this. So they don't feel safe in a relationship. So relationships tend to be conflictual. You get close, you get anxious, you have problems, you have conflicts, you misread the other. So that's the second area of difficulty. The third area of difficulty is in behaviors. People with this disorder often engage in behaviors that are destructive to themselves. Could be self-cutting, overdosing, drug abuse, dangerous, unsafe sexual behaviors. Those are manifestations of the illness, but they are not the core of the illness. The core of the illness is the fourth problem area, which is the sense of self. People with this disorder don't have a clear, comprehensive sense of who they are in the world. They don't have that foundation of a sense of identity that helps us all get through life. They don't know exactly what their direction is, what their meaning is. And when you get right down to the bottom of it, they often say they have a terrible feeling of emptiness inside, which I think is the core of the disorder.
One of the things that we've certainly come to know is that it is very real. It has a very real brain focus, a neurobiology. I think that it has suffered enormously in being thought of as a very sort of mood-driven, the words that very, you know, often sort of are connected with it, manipulative, totally inaccurate, totally pejorative. And I think that contributes to it as an illness that doesn't really somehow stand on its own.
Myth number two, BPD is not a brain disorder like other mental illnesses. Fact, BPD is caused by a malfunction in the emotion processing centers of the brain.
There's been a lot of neurobiologic research into BPD in the past several years. When we look at brain scans of individuals with BPD, we can see that the more emotional part of the brain, more of the area where the amygdala is, that part can be really overactive and easily triggered by situations with other people where they feel rejected. In contrast, the frontal part of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, which we really think of as more of like the brakes on the system, that part can be underactive in social settings. So you have an imbalance between the really intense emotional part of the brain and the more controlled frontal part of the brain. And when that balance is off, that's when we start to see the dysregulation and then the concerning behaviors that can be characteristic of BPD, such as suicidal thinking and self-harm.
You know, if someone is cancels plans with me, instantly I feel just like they hate me. I must have done something wrong. What's wrong with me that they don't want to be with me? And it's not that at all. There could be 100 different reasons that the plans were canceled, but my brain instantly goes to the, you're terrible, you've done something wrong, they hate you, they don't want to be with you, you annoy them, all these terrible thoughts that I wouldn't say about anyone else in the world, yet I say them to myself.
I was having a really good day, and I looked outside and I saw a Christmas wreath, and immediately My emotions hit like a freight train. And what happened, and after thinking about it later on, I could kind of connect those dots. What happened was my first thought was about Christmas and my children and how mental illness has impacted my relationship with my kids. And it's been extremely difficult. So I went from being content and happy and at peace to having suicidal ideation in no time.
Myth number three. BPD is not a serious mental illness. Fact, BPD is associated with self-harm behaviors, suicide, and drug abuse.
I struggled with suicidality a lot and self-harm. It started out when I was a teenager, and then it was first, again, like this fuzzy abstract notion of what being here and being alive meant. And then as it grew over the years towards my diagnosis, it became very specific and concrete, and that's how it kind of changed over time.
The risky behaviors are very real, and I think we need to also be extremely open in recognizing that when you're sitting with someone who says, the only solution is to kill myself and this is what I'm planning to do and researching, it's scary. And this is when it's important to understand what it's coming from, and that this is what we know to be death is obviously a permanent solution to a temporary problem.
The self-harm, hospitalization, suicide attempts, I don't think there are too many mental illnesses that are more serious.
BPD is a serious mental illness because it causes a great deal of serious pathology. A 10% rate of suicide among people who suffer from the disorder, the self-destructiveness that has been mentioned, the cutting, the overdosing, the substance abuse, the unsafe practices. Depression, anxiety are also part of the picture. So it's a serious illness because of the personal suffering it causes, because of the suffering to families, and because of the cost to society.
Myth number four, those diagnosed with BPD are attention-seeking and manipulative. Fact, individuals with BPD sometimes utilize unhealthy behaviors to alleviate emotional pain.
I felt these intense emotions my entire life. And although these are emotions that you also feel, I feel like I feel them on a different level. And really what it's difficult for me to do is it's really difficult for me to cope with those emotions. So I end up doing things or saying things or acting in a way that is not healthy and productive in my life.
Sometimes when families are coming to see me, they'll say that their loved one is just doing this for attention, or they didn't really mean to hurt themselves. They just wanted a certain reaction. And my response to that is usually that humans want to get their needs met. And we do whatever we can to get those needs met and to communicate. And for individuals with BPD, oftentimes they don't have a strong repertoire of really effective ways to do that. So they end up doing things that can feel to the recipient that maybe they're manipulative or that they're not caring. In reality, that's really just the best that person is doing at that given moment to communicate something.
The word manipulation in my world feels like such a slap in the face, because I perceive it instead as someone doing their best to manage really difficult emotions and situations that are difficult for them in the least effective way possible a lot of the time. So you end up doing something that other people perceive as manipulative, and it's the best you can do.
They're born with the brain systems they have, and when they are suffering and respond to things in a very profound way, they don't have the skills with which to reach out and communicate what they need and want. So they find ways to do it that work and that are also extremely taxing on the people they're close to, the treaters they're working with. But it comes from actually a very human instinct. I would like to reframe it as they are profoundly understanding-seeking and connection-seeking.
Number 5, BPD is not treatable. Fact, there are 5 evidence-based treatments for BPD.
There are effective evidence-based treatments for BPD. That's the good news. Since the 1990s, people have devoted themselves to finding good treatments. At this stage, we have 5 major treatments. I can't describe them in detail, so I'll just name them in case people want to look them up. Dialectical behavior treatment, transference-focused psychotherapy, mentalization-based therapy, good psychiatric management, and schema-focused therapy. They all have an evidence base. They have all been shown to help people improve, in some cases symptomatically, which is great, and in some cases even beyond symptomatically, in the sort of fundamental ways the person thinks about him or herself. In other words, their subjective experience of themselves in the world.
So we know there's a number of different therapies for BPD that are effective, that have an evidence base behind them for both adolescents and adults. I think that they have similarities and differences, but a real core component of all of them is having a strong, trusting therapeutic alliance between the individual and the clinician.
With a lot of persistence and a lot of work on the client's part, with a lot of active participation and learning what they need to learn to have BPD and maintain relationships, maintain jobs, and regulate their emotions, people just do amazingly well.
I started having confidence that this was working and this was going to be something that was going to stick was because I could let go. I had a treatment team who was in my corner now. Whatever they were responsible for, I no longer had to think about, and all I had to do was think about how I needed to take care of myself at this particular moment. And that was freeing for me.
It's tricky with misconceptions because we're all individuals, right? Each of our lives are affected differently by this disorder. And for me, luckily for me, I was able to get treatment and starting at 19 years old, and I wanted to change.
As a child psychiatrist, had the privilege of working with people from maybe their early teen years through college, through grad school, and seeing people really say, you know, this was a part of my past, this is a part of who I was, but it's not who I am anymore, and they've really made meaning of it and, you know, moved on to have very meaningful lives.
Myth number 6, it is better not to tell someone they have BPD. Fact, a BPD diagnosis saves lives and promotes recovery.
I think that anything worth doing has risks. I think as doctors, as clinicians, we didn't go into this business to completely avoid risk. I think neurosurgeons, obstetricians, intensive care physicians, all of them are taking on risks and are taking on challenging cases. I think as a psychiatrist, I see working with individuals with severe mental illness is the same way. I see BPD as being part of that. So yes, there are risks, and I think they're worthwhile. I also would say that I think the risks of untreated BPD or misdiagnosed, mislabeled as something else are high, both high for the individual who hasn't been given the proper diagnosis and high for society as a whole, because these people are not kind of living their lives to the fullest.
I think a lot of folks, especially if they come into us as adults, have been passed around from diagnosis to diagnosis, from doctor to doctor, who have told them they have this, they have that, and they do whatever treatment is appropriate for that, and they're still having difficulties or having problems in living, and they're wondering, what's wrong with me?
Unfortunately, the majority of patients with BPD are initially diagnosed with something other than BPD, most often depression or anxiety. Now, those symptoms are part of the picture, but they don't get the whole disorder. So, with those inaccurate diagnoses, people are getting incomplete treatments, partial treatments, not the specialized treatment they need to deal with their whole syndrome of BPD. So a lot of suffering is caused by lack of appropriate diagnosis, seeing only one part of the picture, not getting the whole picture, and applying treatment to a symptom where you need to apply treatment to a whole syndrome.
But I was misdiagnosed for about 17 years. So I was first diagnosed with major depressive disorder. And then over the next 17 years, I was also diagnosed with OCD, generalized anxiety disorder, bipolar disorder. So when I was finally diagnosed at age 35, there was a huge sense of relief. I was finally able to connect the dots and understand why I felt the way I felt and why I did the things that I did.
Telling people that they have BPD is actually, at least in my experience, a huge relief. And it's a relief for, I think, a very simple reason. It is the ultimate validation that what they are suffering has a name, it has an etiology, it has a treatment, it's real.
If I was diagnosed earlier, I would definitely have had a lot less suffering. And suffering, to me, are like times when I've been, you know, stuck in a corner of my bedroom, crying and sobbing, uncontrollably thinking about ways to die. That could have been a lot less.
Myth number 7, people with BPD are not capable of maintaining relationships and commitments. Fact, people with BPD can lead meaningful lives with treatment.
I think when first people come in, their lives are chaotic and difficult and really hard on a daily basis. And what you find is the difficulty and the chaos get better and go much more into the background. So you'll find a calmness and a contentment and a consistency over time with treatment that gives folks the life that they've been looking to lead.
I've been in treatment for 7 years now, going on 8, and it's still a daily struggle. I still live with many of the symptoms of BPD, but that doesn't stop me because I find ways through treatment to go to school, to have a job, to maintain relationships. I've been with my boyfriend for 3 years now. I've been with my job as a nanny for 2.5. And if I wasn't given the treatment that I was given, I wouldn't have any of those.
I have a son who's 3 years old, and at first, I had very low self-esteem that I could actually do this thing called parenting.
Individuals with BPD have many strengths, typically are extremely intelligent, often talented in many artistic ways, but also enormously empathic and compassionate. And when the treatment moves along and some of the more painful aspects of their existence become more resolved, you know, they actually can form extremely deep attachments, strong therapeutic relationships, be loving parents, and extremely devoted friends.
I'm more attuned to him, especially when he's about to get upset, or if he's upset, to know where there was a trigger that might have upset him, or even just making sure that he's being fed at the appropriate time and getting his sleep. And, you know, just understanding that, you know, all of these skills that I've learned in therapy can apply to helping grow and build my son.
If I could just go back and talk to the psychiatrist who correctly diagnosed me in 2015, I would give him a big thank you and a handshake or hug. The fact that he took a chance on me and really could have saved my life without a correct diagnosis, I really don't know if I'd be here today.
My advice to a young clinician is to appreciate how gratifying treating patients with BPD can be.
For anyone who is treating people with borderline personality disorders, from my experience, I would just hope that you believe in your patients. And not just believe what they say, but believe in them wholeheartedly, who they are and why it's important for them to be here.